Okay, so my name is Nia Jafar. Originally, this talk was called React Ninja Fast, but since the internet has existed, my name has autocorrect to Ninja all the time, so I have a love-hate relationship with that word. So I decided to just go ahead and just do a control F replace and just replace Ninja with my name instead. So we have React Ninja, Nia Jafar. I can't even say it right anymore. But I'm just basically talking about React to give a brief overview and a little bit about why we at C3B chose React. So whenever you're choosing a database, you usually come into contact with the CAP theorem, which basically says you can't have all the things. You can only choose two. And React actually sits in between, or sits with the partition tolerance and availability, giving up consistency. So you might ask, why would a company like C3B give up consistency? We deal with payment methods, we deal with payment tokens. Why would we give up consistency? So, like you just heard from Brianne, C3B sits in an interesting place. We're between the merchant and the payment gateway. So that means we have tons of transactions hitting us all the time, so we need to be available. When people don't get their money, they get very upset. Also, the way that we design our data is very hard for us not to have consistent data, so we actually don't have to really worry about that too often. So what is React? React is a NoSQL key value database with local and multi-cluster replication. So there are a lot of NoSQL databases out there nowadays, so why is React actually different? React is actually made for big data, and one of the ways it does that is it's data type agnostic. That means that we can shove anything we want into that value field. It doesn't matter, it doesn't care what that is actually is or what data type it is. It also has high availability. One of the ways it also does that is it's massless, which is great, because slavery was still 1800s. Pause this for laughter. The way that it does that is that it has several clusters. None of the clusters are exactly the same. And each of the clusters can decide exactly where the data gets stored. So if one cluster goes down, it's not that big of an issue. But in a master-slave relationship, that could be a big issue. There's also a lot of flexibility in how we handle conflicts. So by default, there is vector pops. But we also have CRDTs, but who really knows what those are anyway? There's also last write wins, if you want to do the timestamp. But at the end of the day, you can also do application side management. So you can decide exactly how to handle each conflict as it comes up. But as with any choice, there's positives and negatives. You always have to give up something. So what are the repercussions of actually choosing React? One of those repercussions is it's NoSQL. So we don't have those databases that are easy to query. But we'll talk a little bit later about how we actually address that issue. Also, there's no active records. So some of us that came with additional Rails background, we can't really do some of those queries that we're used to. And also, Bastion went out of business, the company that used to support React. So that's also a big downside. But I'm sure you guys want to know more about it. So we do have an amazing blog on our website that talks about how we transitioned to React and also how we transitioned to Kafka as well. And actually, Mike is going to talk next about how replication happens on React, followed by David, who is going to talk about Kafka.